Dear students, today we will discuss another very important topic, that is adenoids. Adenoids are a mass of lymphoid tissue which is situated at the junction of roof and the posterior wall of nasopharynx. They are also called nasopharyngeal tonsil. The other tonsils which are present in this area are the tubal tonsils, which are present around the tube of the around the eustachian tube opening, the lingual tonsils, which are present at the base of tongue, and the palatine tonsils, which are present in the oropharynx. So these four mass of lymphoid tissue, they form a ring called Waldeyer's ring. The adenoid usually undergoes atrophy by puberty, that is at the age of 13 to 14 years. You can see in this picture, this is the location of adenoids. This is the soft palate. This is the nose, and these are the turbinates. So if the adenoid mass is filling more than 2/3 of the width of nasopharynx, then it can be a problem. So you will have to do something for it. You have to go for medical treatment, or mostly surgical treatment is needed. It is a pink globular mass, and there are vertical ridges on its surface, but there are no crypts, and it is lined by the ciliated columnar epithelium, and also there is no capsule. This is the difference between the adenoids and the tonsils, and that the tonsils contain crypts, and the tonsil also contain capsule, but there is no crypts and no capsule in adenoids. What is the blood supply of adenoid? It's the ascending palatine branch of facial artery, ascending pharyngeal artery, and the pharyngeal branch of the third part of maxillary artery. And what is the lymphatic drainage? The lymph from the adenoids, it drain into the upper deep jugular nodes, the retropharyngeal nodes, and the parapharyngeal nodes. You can see in this x-ray, this is the x-ray soft tissue neck lateral view showing the adenoid, which is covering more than 2/3 of the space of the nasopharynx. So you can see that there is a very little space here by which the patient or child can breathe. So what is the etiology? Etiology can be hereditary due to the cold climate, due to the specific infections like tuberculosis, and mostly it is physiological hypertrophy and may be seen in between the 3 to 10 years of age, and after all it will start atrophying. What are the symptoms? Among the local symptoms, the patient can present to you with bilateral nasal obstruction, snoring, mouth breathing, rhinolalia clausa, frequent rhinorrhea, epistaxis, that is bleeding from the nose, the feeding problems in children because the nose is blocked, conductive deafness due to the eustachian tube blockade. It can also lead to cervical lymphadenopathy. Due to the tube blockade, it can also cause otitis media. It can also cause adenoid facies and bronchitis. Among the general symptoms, the patient can present to you with anorexia, lethargy, poor physical and mental development, bedwetting, pigeon chest, and protuberant abdomen. Adenoid facies is very typical, the adenoid hypertrophy, that is those children who breathe from mouth for a long period of time, they actually develop sunken eyes, narrow pinched nostrils, open mouth, high arched palate, crowded teeth, dull mask-like face, protruding teeth, drooling saliva, everted upper lip, and rhinorrhea. So all these features are features of adenoid facies. You should always remember. So what are the manifestations of adenoid hypertrophy? Adenoid hypertrophy can cause otalgia due to the blockade of tube. It can also cause secretory otitis media, and ultimately when there is infection in the ear, it can cause otitis, acute otitis media. It can also cause retraction of the tympanic membrane, resulting in atelectasis, and tube blockade and chronic otitis media can also occur. So how will you diagnose these patients? They present you with nasal obstruction and rhinorrhea. On examination, you can see pink globular mass with vertical ridges on posterior rhinoscopy. On ear examination, you can see bilateral retracted eardrums, and on X-ray nasopharynx lateral view, shows soft tissue mass filling the nasopharynx. What are the differential diagnoses of the adenoids? Include the Thornwald cyst. So, what are the complications of adenoid facies? And we have already discussed otitis media with effusion, recurrent acute otitis media, rhinolalia clausa, chronic sinusitis, sleep apnea syndrome, and decreased mental and physical development. And what is the treatment of adenoid hypertrophy? Medical treatment include adequate nutrition, antibiotics, anti-inflammatory analgesics, and nasal decongestant drops. But mostly, if it is filling more than 2/3 of the space of the nasopharynx, then we have to go for surgery. The surgery is called adenoidectomy. If the patient also have decreased hearing due to otitis media with effusion, you will have to go for myringotomy and grommet insertion along with the adenoidectomy. Okay, now I will tell you a bit about adenoidectomy. What are the indications of adenoidectomy? Adenoid hypertrophy causing snoring, mouth breathing, sleep apnea syndrome, or speech abnormalities. Recurrent rhinosinusitis. Chronic secretory otitis media associated with adenoid hypertrophy. Then the recurrent ear discharge in benign CSOM associated with adenoiditis and adenoid hyperplasia. And dental malocclusion. And what are the contraindications of doing adenoidectomy? First is the cleft palate, then the hemorrhagic disorders, and acute upper respiratory tract infection is also contraindication. Anesthesia is always general anesthesia with oral endotracheal tube intubation. And what will be the position during this surgery? Position will be Rose position. It means that the neck is extended by a sandbag under the shoulders and the head is supported on a ring. What are the steps of operation? Boyle Lewis mouth gag is inserted, and before actual removal of the adenoids, adenoids should be actually palpated to assess the size of adenoid mass, to push the lateral adenoid mass towards the midline. Then the proper size of adenoid curette is introduced in the nasopharynx, and adenoids are actually shaved off, but the head should be slightly flexed in this maneuver to avoid injury to the odontoid process. This is the adenoid curette with guard, and this is adenoid curette without guard. Then with gentle sweeping movements, adenoids are shaved off. You should always remain in the midline. You should not go laterally, because laterally you can injure the eustachian tube openings. Hemostasis is achieved by packing the area for some time, and persistent bleeders are electrocoagulated under vision. And if the bleeding is not controlled, both nasal pack is left for 24 hours. These days, endoscopic removal is done, and it can be removed more precisely by using a debrider under endoscopic control. This is a micro debrider. It actually eats away all the tissue, comes in its way. Here you can see these are the adenoid tissue, and this is a micro debrider. Here you can also see that the adenoid tissue is being sucked inside the micro debrider. There is another way by which the adenoidectomy can be done. This is called coblation adenoidectomy. It is also called cold ablation. This technique utilizes the field of plasma or ionized sodium molecules to ablate the tissues, and the heat generated varies from the 40 to 80 degrees, and it is much lower than that of electrocautery. And the patient have reduced postoperative pain and reduced bleeding in this procedure. And what is the immediate care after surgery? Keep the patient in lateral position until fully recovered from anesthesia. Keep a watch on bleeding from the nose and mouth, and keep check on vital signs, that is pulse, respiration, and blood pressure. When the patient is fully recovered, he can take liquids, and nasal saline drops are also used. To reduce the bleeding, analgesics are used, and to avoid postoperative infection, antibiotics are usually used for a week. And the patient is usually sent home after 24 hours if there is no complication. What are the complications of adenoidectomy? First of all, is the hemorrhage, then the injury to the eustachian tube opening. To avoid this injury, you should always remain in the midline while shaving off the adenoids. Then injury to the pharyngeal musculature and vertebra. One very gruesome complication of adenoidectomy is the Grisel syndrome. In this, the patient complains of neck pain and develops torticollis. Mostly it is due to the spasm of the paraspinal muscles, but it can be due to atlantoaxial dislocation. It can be life-threatening and patient can require cervical collar or even traction. And the nasopharyngeal stenosis can also occur, and next complication are the recurrence. Thank you.